Today we're going to be looking at Ecclesiastes chapter 9, starting in verse 13, and then we're going to read the entirety of chapter 10 as well. So this is a bit of a longer reading. I have been handling a chapter at a time, but the end of chapter 9 kind of lent itself to the content and the theme of God's wisdom in chapter 10, so I'm going to handle that all together here. What you're going to hear in the Word today, and Solomon, if he's our author here, has done this before, where it's a chapter, just sort of a collection of wise sayings. You know, it may have a couple of different themes. He's done that earlier in Ecclesiastes. He certainly did that in the book of Proverbs. So this chapter today, you'll hear several different themes, but it's all under the theme of him sharing wisdom with us, about teaching us God's way to live and how to live wisely instead of foolishly. So let's look at Ecclesiastes 9, verse 13. I have also seen the example of wisdom under the sun, and it seemed great to me. There was a little city with few men in it, and a great king came against it and besieged it, building great siege works against it. But there was found in it a poor wise man, and he by his wisdom delivered the city. Yet no one remembered that poor man. But I say that wisdom is better than might, though the poor man's wisdom is despised and his words are not heard. The words of the wise heard in quiet are better than the shouting of a ruler among fools. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much good. Dead flies make the perfumer's ointment give off a stench, so a little folly outweighs wisdom and honor. A wise man's heart inclines him to the right, but a fool's heart to the left. Even when the fool walks on the road, he lacks sense, and he says to everyone that he is a fool. If the anger of the ruler rises against you, do not leave your place, for calmness will lay great offenses to rest. There is an evil that I have seen under the sun, as it were an error proceeding from the ruler. Folly is set in many high places, and the rich sit in a low place. I have seen slaves on horses and princes walking on the ground like slaves. He who digs a pit will fall into it, and a serpent will bite him who breaks through a wall. He who quarries stones is hurt by them, and he who splits logs is endangered by them. If the iron is blunt and one does not sharpen the edge, he must use more strength, but wisdom helps one to succeed. If the serpent bites before it is charmed, then there is no advantage to the charmer. The words of the wise man's mouth win him favor, but the lips of a fool consume him. The beginning of the words of his mouth is foolishness, and the end of his talk is evil madness. A fool multiplies words, though no man knows what is to be, and who can tell him what will be after him? The toil of a fool wearies him, for he does not know the way to the city. Woe to you, O land, when your king is a child and your princes feast in the morning. Happy are you, O land, when your king is the son of the nobility and your princes feast at the proper time for strength and not for drunkenness. Through sloth, the roof sinks in, and through indolence, the house leaks. Bread is made for laughter, and wine gladdens life, and money answers everything. Even in your thoughts, do not curse the king, nor in your bedroom curse the rich, for a bird of the air will carry your voice, or some winged creature tell the matter. Father, we thank you for your word that we have heard read aloud today, and we just pray that you would speak to us, help us to gain insight as we look at your word more deeply. We are thankful you reveal yourself to us through the written word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. So he started out this section and he says in chapter 9, verse 13, I have also seen this example of wisdom and it seemed great to me. So I was just looking through the first few verses here and it almost seemed like a math problem. Maybe it's because I'm thinking about people going back to school, starting up school again here. But he kind of does these comparisons. And by the way, in second grade, I had a really hard time with the whole, you know, which way this thing goes. And finally, somebody explained to me, it wants to eat the thing that's bigger and better. I'm like, oh, and then it all made sense to me here. So this is kind of what happens here. He is showing us what is desired is wisdom, God's wisdom here. And he shares it in several different ways. He says the first one in verses 14 and 15, a poor, heroic, forgotten wise man is greater or better than a great king. Okay, this king that has everything, he has all power and authority, that's really in the ways of God is worth less than the poor, heroic, forgotten guy that was wise and did the right thing. Okay, that's the first one. Then he says, just more simply here, he says, wisdom is greater. Wisdom is better than might in verse 16. And then he says, wise words in quiet are better or greater than shouting, the shouting of a ruler among fools, this ruler that has to say, I'm great and powerful. He's like, actually, it's better if you're just quiet. Okay, wise words of the quiet is better, it's greater. And then he says, very simply in this first part of verse 18, wisdom is greater than the weapons of war. Not that there's not a time for war and for justice to be done in that way, but he says, think carefully before you go to that. Be wise, be slow to speak here. Wisdom is greater than weapons of war, okay? And then he moves into something else. It's connected to wisdom, though. He loves to take some things and help us understand what it is. And he's going to illustrate wisdom in several different ways. I was just thinking about how sometimes something very small can ruin something that's big and great. I think, especially living in Midvale, one of my favorite things is when we finally get to go eat out. I always have particular things in mind. When I go to Ontario, I want to go to Fiesta Guadalajara, and I want to have chicken fajitas, and I can taste it. You know, I know exactly what's going to happen, and the friendly servers are going to come up, and they're going to offer it, and it's going to come very quickly, and I'm really excited about it. So I've got that taste in my mind, and it's never happened, but what if I get there, and I'm ready for it, and they bring up my fajitas sizzling. Oh, I love the sound. I can hear it coming from afar. I'm like, it's me, I'm going to get it. You know, and it comes and they place it on my table and I'm ready to dig in and I look down and what if there was a big long hair weaving its way through the chicken? Ruined. You know, I don't want to eat any of that now. One example. Or perhaps you are wanting to get out in nature and you go out on a hike. You're heading up on Hit Mountain, which we have illustrated in the fellowship hall. I've mentioned that before. But you're going up on a hike, you know, and you're smelling, especially in late spring, early summertime, you're getting up amongst the wildflowers there and just smells wonderful. God's creation is aromatic and beautiful. It's awesome. You're getting up there and then all of a sudden the stench of something hits you and you see there's a dead animal right in the middle of it. All of a sudden, I can't smell those beautiful flowers. The stench of that death is weaving through it here. Or really, maybe you're just sitting down to a great movie that you want to enjoy, and everything about the movie is wonderful. There's a great story, there's great cinematography, there's great soundtrack, even great dialogue, and you love the story as it's going along. And it's even clean for the most part until they throw in one gratuitous scene that just ruins the whole thing. This is what Solomon is saying here when he says in the latter part of verse 18, but one sinner destroys much good. One small thing can ruin the rest of this. And he illustrates it in other ways. And we are familiar with this already. You've probably grown up hearing this phrase, a rotten apple ruins the whole barrel.
Oh, I heard that.
She's heard that. I don't know about the rest of you. Okay, so you've heard that before, right? And he goes on to illustrate it in other ways. Dead flies makes the perfumer's ointment give off a stench. Okay, so the perfumer's ointment is supposed to make people smell good, and especially in the ancient Near East, when they couldn't just easily take a shower every day, I mean, getting cleansed like that was a difficult thing. They would just kind of put on some perfumer's ointment to kind of cover up the body odor and make them smell a little bit better when they're around other people. But what if a fly dies in that perfumer's ointment, and then you're putting it on, you look down at and there may be more than one, right? He says that just ruins the whole thing. It gives off a stench now. And then the latter part of verse 1 of chapter 10, a little folly outweighs wisdom and honor. One stupid choice. Sorry I said stupid, Emmeline. One dumb choice can outweigh all of the wise that you did. Wisdom is really being upheld here by Solomon. He says in a couple of ways now, he's comparing wisdom as what's greater than the other thing. Wisdom always is. And then foolishness, if it's not rooted out, ruins a wise life. So Solomon is saying, choose wise living, not foolishness. Now, Solomon is going to compare living your life now. He takes another way to look at this now. Living your life to the way you walk. Imagine your life as a pathway. You have a destination that you're heading towards. And he says, stay on course. Don't be distracted as you're going along here. And verse 2, he says, walking the right way and not to the left. Okay, this is, don't get in your mind politics here. He's talking about walking God's way. Walking according to his way that he's set up before you, not your own way that you think is so good and important. And then I love it because after he's talking about walking the right way here, he gives an example of a fool who he says, even when the fool walks in the road, he lacks sense and he says to everyone that he's a fool. Now, it's not necessarily that he's walking along going, hey, I'm a fool, guys. He's walking in the middle of the road. Okay, he's going to get run over. By his action, he is saying that he is foolish here. And I can't help but remember my early days growing up here in Midvale, a moment like this, where I was staying the night with a friend of mine and several of us were together. You know, we're 17, 18 years old, we know it all. And so about 2 o'clock in the morning, we still hadn't gone to bed yet, foolish. We like, hey, let's go downtown and see what's going on. And in 1989, there was nothing going on in Midvale, in the middle of town. It's still kind of the same now, but there's more of nothing than there was back then, okay? Right. So we go downtown in our sleeping bags, and we get down to the highway, and we're like, hey, and one of my friends goes, hey, I brought Monopoly. I'm like, okay, let's play Monopoly in the middle of the highway. Sounds smart. So we set on our sleeping bags, we set up Monopoly. Nothing's happening on Highway 95 in 1989 at 2:30 in the morning now. So we play Monopoly for a while. We don't see a soul. And then finally we hear a big truck is finally coming, you know? So we're like, well, actually, this is the moment we were waiting for. Get Monopoly off. We're trying to remember how much money we have. Pull that off the side of the road. Get in our sleeping bags and stand right by the highway. As the truck is coming into town. And I don't know what we were trying to prove, but we thought it would freak him out. And he went by, and I don't know what he was thinking, but I'm guessing he probably says, that guy is saying he's a fool, standing by the side of the highway in the middle of the night. Okay, there's a chapter from my own life that you can use against me later on. The fool says by his actions that he is a fool. Now, there's a lot of language here about our tongues as well in this chapter here about what we say reveals the foolishness within our own lives here. So verse 3, like I just read, you know, the fool says to everyone that he's a fool by what he's doing here, but also in the words that we speak. Verse 4, he says, if the anger of the ruler rises against you, do not leave your place, for calmness will lay great offenses to rest. Think about the use of your tongue here. When something big is happening, we want to try to start speaking. That's one of the things as parents, you've probably experienced plenty of times. Your kid has done something wrong. They know they've done something wrong. You say their name and you're ready to start addressing the issue and they start talking because they know they're in trouble. And you're, stop, okay? Same thing here. He says, if the anger of a ruler rises against you, do not leave your place. Calmness will lay great offenses to rest. Be still. Be quiet. Think about the use of your tongue. Be quiet before him. Then verses 12 and 13, the words of a wise man's mouth win him favor, but the lips of a fool consume him. Okay? By what we say, we can ruin things here. A wise man will say few words, and they'll be wise. And then, verse 14, a fool multiplies words. Are there moments in your life you wish you could take back? Especially moments in your life when you wish you could take back words you said. And probably in those moments, you're saying a lot more than you should, and you keep going, trying to fix it, but you're not getting any better. And you should listen to the voice that's going, shut up, shut up, be quiet. Just like dead flies in the perfume, foolish words ruin the whole event. And now, if I haven't confessed enough about stupidity in my life, I have another one for you about multiplying words and how foolish words can ruin the whole event. There was a funeral that I did one time, and the family was all together, and it was just a wonderful time of sharing. And the family was talking about these generations that were all there, how many generations were a part of it. And they said, oh, if so-and-so had her baby already, then there would have been one more generation represented here. Oh, man. If the timing would have been a little bit different, one more generation would have been here, right? So I have this in my mind. And afterwards, I'm talking to everybody, and the young lady that hadn't had that baby yet was standing there talking to me. And I said, oh, man, by the way, when are you due? And she goes, I'm not pregnant. I'm just fat. I'm like, I just, from 6'4", I just went down to like 3'2" in that moment. And it's one of those, it's one of those moments. I mean, it should be written in stone. Every man knows not to ask a question like that. But I did. I couldn't cover it up. And so the fool said these words, and that whole event in my mind was ruined. And I still wish I could go back and take that back. But there it is. It was out. The dead fly. I thrust a whole pile of dead flies in that ointment that day. A fool multiplies words. And then the final one in verse 20, he says, even in your thoughts, do not curse the king, nor in your bedroom curse the rich, for a bird of the air will carry your voice. Now, we read that, and it's not like, I mean, does the king like employ birds as spies? That they can be there and like, I heard that, you know, and fly out and tell him. That's not really what's going on here. The king isn't that powerful, but think about this. Where do your words come from? The words that you speak. They come from your thoughts. They come from your heart. Matthew 12:34 says, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. I think about Jesus' words in the Sermon on the Mount, the beginning of it, chapter 5, verses 21 through 48. He addresses six things that people have talked commonly about. And then he kind of changes it a little bit, or he raises the bar way higher than it was. For instance, he'll say, you know, you've heard that it's wrong to kill or wrong to murder, but I say don't even be angry with a brother. You've heard it said, you know, it's wrong to commit adultery, but I say to you, don't even lust in your own heart. So what is going on when Jesus said that? He says, well, why is anger wrong? Because the imagination of that leads to murder. You don't kill somebody before you've imagined it first. Why is lust wrong? Because imagining that leads to the act of. So before a person commits adultery, they've imagined it in their mind and in their hearts. So before these things happen, Solomon says, don't speak it. Don't think it, okay? That would be foolish. Be careful about what you're imagining and thinking before you speak. Okay, continuing wise living here, he talks a lot about the tongue, but he also addresses life events. This is the way Koheleth, our teacher, our preacher, loves to do. He's reflecting on life, and he's at the tail end of his life, most likely here, where he's lived a lot and reflected on a lot of things. He says in verses 8 and 9, hey, life is unpredictable. And he talks about a couple of men on a particular day. That's kind of interesting. He who digs a pit will fall into it. A serpent will bite him who breaks through a wall. He who quarries stones is hurt by them. He who splits logs is endangered by them. You get the idea here. We've got these construction guys who are doing excavation. They've done it for decades. The guy who's in a quarry working, the guy who's a lumberjack he's working with, he's been careful, he's been working all his life, he knows what this is like, he knows how to be safe, and then all of a sudden something happens that has never happened before, and The wall breaks through. The log rolls down and hits him. Just like that, life can be altered or ended altogether. Life is unpredictable, he says. You just never know. And that's verses 10 and 11, a little bit more here. You never know when death may break in. And then he says, so here's what you do when you never know that. Plan for it. Prepare for it. That's wise. If the iron is blunt, one does not sharpen the edge, he must use more strength. Wisdom helps one to succeed. Prepare for that because it's unpredictable. You never know when it's going to be, when it's going to happen. Be careful, be prepared, think about it, plan ahead. And then he gets to verse 18. He says, through sloth, the roof sinks in, and through indolence, the house leaks. Kind of continuing in this construction language of things here. We think about what it requires to build something. Construction needs good planning, good supplies, good building, the way you do it, in order for it to last. And then careful, consistent maintenance has to continue after that if the building is going to stay up. Otherwise, it will cave in. And I'm thinking about a spot out in my garage where it's hanging down like this, and it's kind of white, and it's mildewed because there's a leak up on the roof that I can't figure out. Trent's looked at it. I've looked at it. I don't know where that's coming from. So I just leave it for another time. It doesn't seem like wisdom, but that's what I'm doing. Or the leak that's underneath my sink. Haven't quite had the time to figure out how to get underneath there with my long arms and how to fix this thing. So I've left a bucket under there, and we empty that here and there. Not sure that that's wisdom, but that's what I've done. What about your home? What about your family? What about your own soul? Is the world slowly drip, drip, dripping on what you haven't tended to? There's a book that I have read to my sons by Mansfield is the last name. Perfect name for the book, Mansfield. And his book is titled Mansfield's Book for Manly Men. I feel more manly just saying the title, okay? It's a wonderful book, and he lays out, I think for young men, our culture especially today, men need to hear who they're supposed to be because the language of our culture is so confusing. And one of the things Mansfield talks about is you as a man need to tend your area. What are you responsible for? By the way, this is good for all people. Men and women both have their areas of things. But the example he uses in his book is that he said, when I was in high school, I was a defensive lineman and I wasn't doing my job and I kept letting people through. And the coach at one of the timeouts grabbed me by the face mask and took me out to the spot and shoved my face in the grass and said, this is your zone. Don't let anybody through it. And then he said, let's talk tomorrow after practice. And so he came to practice the next day, and the coach said, okay, see this section here? It's 5 feet by 5 feet. This is your square, and you're going to tend it all week long. Here's some scissors. Keep it short and trimmed. Okay, keep it clean. This is your zone. And so all week, he'd go out there and he was trimming and he was watching people go over and they'd drop like a wrapper on it. And he'd be like, hey, that's my area. And he'd take it and go throw that away, you know. And as he continued to tend it, all of a sudden he became defensive about it. And so Mansfield says, what is your zone? What are your responsibilities? What's your area of things for life? You need to tend it. You need to take care of your home. You need to take care of your family. You need to tend to your own soul. And it takes maintenance. Don't let the drip, drip, dripping of life wear that away. So I ask you today, is your life in order? Solomon says here, a wise man's heart inclines him to the right, but a fool's heart to the left. And I like this analogy of walking our way through life. Because life really isn't about getting everything right on all of the really big questions. It really seems to come down to lots and lots of small decisions along the way that keep us going on the trail. It's a direction, life is. It's slow, it's steady. And if you're going the wrong way, you can turn around. It's one thing I want to tell you today is if you feel like you're taking the wrong direction in your life or you've gotten off the trail a little bit, you can turn around and come back. The Bible calls that repentance. You can change from where you're going and you can come back. And if you're going the right way, he says, be steady and keep going. Don't give up. Keep enduring. Keep walking along. So which way are you walking? And in the words of Solomon today, let's just look at a couple of areas in your life. The first one here is, you know, are you taking care of your home and your life? And I'm looking out at some of you and some of you kids. What are your areas of life? Maybe, Andrew, keeping your bed made, keeping your room. I may have touched something on there. Keeping your room clean and in order, doing your studies, doing your chores, you know, minding the relationships in your family. You know, what are the areas you have? Little kids have less. The older you get, you have more responsibilities, more areas that you need to tend to. And it takes work. But the more that you do it and take pride in that, it's kind of like Mansfield, that's like you do it well. God's working with you and through you to keep your area well. But it starts with your own soul. You can't tend to anything else until you've tended to yourself. So is your own soul, is your own life in order? Is Jesus first in your life? Some of us may have made him Savior, but not really made him Lord. He has to be first in all things. The song we sang before this, Jesus is Lord. You know, it means he's in control of everything. And when he's in control of all things, life goes the right direction. Are you taking care of your home and life? If you're not, today would be the right day to come back on that trail. We would love to help you in that. Or for some of the rest of us, maybe you've already made Jesus Lord of your life, but maybe you're not controlling your tongue. And this is something that Solomon addressed here quite a bit. Proverbs and James have a lot to say about the tongue as well. And the scriptures are very plain that the tongue has the power to build up or to destroy. And in this vein, I'd remind you of one of the ways we use our tongues today more than what Solomon would have understood in his time. There's nothing new under the sun, but maybe the way we do it is a little bit different here. Not just what we speak, but also what we type we need to be thinking about here. Social media can be a tool that can build up or tear down. And I've seen it used well with people's pictures of God's creation, with scriptures that challenge and encourage, with words that build up other people and challenge other people in good and godly ways. I've also seen people's words in social media tear down, and it often comes in rants. Just like somebody's coming on, I've got a rant. I'm like, oh, great. You know, and they just go on and on through it. And they didn't stop and think, should I write this? Solomon would say, with calmness, wait. Don't speak it. I think Solomon would approve of Thumper from Bambi. If you can't say something nice, don't say nothing at all. You've seen that. Keeping with this analogy of a dead fly in the ointment, one small thing can ruin everything else. Now, this isn't to say that God is calling us that you have to get everything perfect. There is no one righteous, no, not one. You're not going to do that. But sometimes we can be going along in our life and we're just not really thinking. We need to be paying close attention to our walk. There's no downtime when you should go on autopilot here. And if you do, you'll probably look up and find out you're off the trail and you've wandered far. And this isn't for you today to go, hey, I know a guy like that. When Kevin's saying this, that's like so-and-so. No, Solomon is saying, I'm talking to you. This is for you today. God is saying this word is for you. So what is the state of your house? What is the state of your life? And I want to finish with Jesus' words from the end of the Sermon on the Mount, when he says, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock." Everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain fell, the floods came, the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. So you've heard the word of God today. What will you do with it? Will you foolishly walk away thinking, "Oh, he's talking about so-and-so or these other people"? Or will you apply the word of God to your own life, to your own house? How can you keep the dead fly out? How can you stay on the path? Well, it's by putting Jesus first in your life and then every day remembering to keep him there. When Jesus calls a man, he bids him come and die. Deny yourself daily, pick up your cross, and follow him, making Jesus not just Savior, but Lord. Is he Lord of your life today? If he's not, as we sing, I would love for someone to come forward and say, "I want my life to be different. I want to turn around and come back on God's pathway." Or even if you have made him Lord of your life already, and today you realize you've wandered a little bit, I'd love for you to come forward, and the church will pray for you and encourage you and lift you up. So let's stand and sing our invitation song.
Good morning, everybody. Yeah, this morning I got a call from Larry just a couple hours ago asking me to fill in for him. And so then I started thinking, what am I going to say? You know, Kevin usually sends us an email early in the week to really lay out what we need to say. And so I didn't have that. So I had to kind of lean on what happened during this week. And it was kind of interesting seeing those first two songs, kind of what I was thinking about talking about. Is Heather this week was filling out her job application for a new job, and it was talking about beneficiaries in case of her death. And that's always a hard subject for a lot of people. You know, you don't want to think about death, but you have to plan for it. Then I've seen in real estate so many good planning and bad planning when it comes to real estate. And I started thinking about Jesus's death and how he planned way ahead of a time, and how he planned for all of us, and what great planning it was for our inheritance of his salvation. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Lord. As we go about this week, Lord, ahead of us, let us be grateful for the inheritance that Jesus gave for us, the sacrifice of his death, Lord, and we just thank you for all the blessings that we have in our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Go ahead. Dear God, thank you so much for the sacrifice that your son gave on the cross. And I pray that as we partake of the fruit of the vine, that it will remind us of that and remind us to tell others, and that life's not over yet, and help us to make the most of it and letting others know and just spreading the word. In Jesus' name, amen.
So just a couple months ago, we did VBS here, and I got to teach some of the classes, and I knew the stuff that we'd be talking about, but I like to study just a little bit, just in case, you know, kids had different questions. And I was looking at different stuff on YouTube, and one of the things I found was about giving. And it was such a simple thing for kids, but I think it's very simple for all of us adults too. And if we look at God, it starts with a G, and so does giving and generosity. If we look at Satan, starts with an S, and that's selfishness. So today, as we're here giving an offering now, let us think about the G in God in giving. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. We are so blessed as a congregation, and the giving that we do, and that we can go out and support this community, and we can support others, not only in the U.S., but around the world, Lord. And We just thank you so much that we are able to do all that and that we can continue to do all that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.